Hi, I'm Mike North. I'm a principal staff engineer at Stripe and the tech lead of their developer platform org. In TypeScript Fundamentals, a course great for beginners and those looking to reinforce the basics, we'll build a solid framework for understanding how to think in types. We'll learn about lots of language features, like how to type variables, objects, arrays, functions, and classes. We'll do a deep study of interfaces and type aliases and learn when it's appropriate to use one or the other. By the end of the course, you'll be creating your own type parameterized generic functions, which is going way beyond the basics and setting you up for success as an impactful contributor to a real TypeScript project. Now we are in the context of a TypeScript file, and TypeScript is not super happy that we have these things and that they are not typed. So we're going to give those types here. You can do the same technique here. So we're adding colon number and colon number, and GitHub Codepilot is trying to help me out here and add another number. So this represents the return value here. It's a lot more syntax, but you'll get used to it, meaning you're going to see colons all over the place, and it gets a little odd if you're used to seeing parentheses and then the open brace right after it. Like, it's a little noisy, but now we can see A is a number, B is a number, and we return a number. And if we just change this, this will type check. So here, let's see what the type error is here. So previously, before we had this return type here, we can go back. You see that we were able to get this result, which is an any, and we were able to pass this in. Some of you didn't even notice. I didn't notice it just now. We passed this in as the argument to a promise constructor. What should we be passing to a promise constructor? Like, in general, what type of value?
Callback function.
This is a callback. It's a function. But because this is an any, TypeScript isn't warning us that there's a problem here, right? You have to spot this. This is part of the benefit of using TypeScript, right? So if we go back and we add these back in, now this is starting to come to our attention. So hopefully some of you in the chat and some of you at home who are wondering, like, what's the value of adding TypeScript to your code? It helps you catch these kinds of things more reliably. And even once you adopt TypeScript, if you have anys, you know, these sort of wildcard types floating around in your code base, I mean, you'll start out that way, particularly if you have a JavaScript code base and you convert to TypeScript. Like, you'll incrementally get to stronger and stronger types. But these effectively, like, untyped values floating around, they can, you know, silently be there waiting. It's like a bug that's waiting to happen. And this is part of what TypeScript helps you catch more easily. Normally, like, if this were a JavaScript code base, I mean, maybe we have a linter that's smart enough to catch this, but if not, you know, you have to wait for a user to go through this code path, or you better hope you have test coverage here, where you would see, like, okay, the promise constructor blows up because it has no callback passed to it.
Do you still need ESLint with TypeScript?
Very good question. ESLint and TypeScript work really well together. TypeScript is all about type checking, right? It's doing its work whenever an argument is passed to a function like this. Remember that we had red squiggles here when it was this, you know, this string 4. So TypeScript's great at catching this. It's great at catching, you know, like, assignment errors or things like this up here. It doesn't really try to do much for you in terms of code style and sort of best practices. So I look at them almost as like a low level and a high level concept. And in fact, ESLint rules that are written to use type information can be incredibly useful. So there is a project called TypeScript-ESLint, which I think the TypeScript core team, you know, contributes to significantly. And it's sort of, it's like more information for lint rules to use. And you can start to get really crisp about the kinds of, you know, problems that you detect. So don't throw away your linter. It's even more valuable with TypeScript. So let's say that we have something that represents an amount, right? We've got a currency type and a value. So you could say like $300 Canadian, something like that. And let's say we wanted to define a function called printAmount. Well, what we've done here is we've created a type alias. So we're saying type amount equals, and then look at the right side of this. It's definitely a type, right? There are no commas here. This is a string, like the string and number. These are types, they're not values. This is one of the only times you will see type information on the right side of an assignment. And this is something that will completely like melt away as part of the compile process. This will get erased from your code, not your source code, but like when you do your build, this will just completely disappear. Because we've defined this and we've given it a name, look at this. We can use it in place of what would have been, you know, a literal type like this. So instead of doing this, we can just say that's amount. We could use this in a bunch of different places. You can, of course, export it, import it, as we'll see later. So here I've got an object I'm creating called donation, and it's valid. So there's no need that I say this is an amount. It must be an amount. It's literally just a shorthand for an explicitly defined type. There's no other formality to it. Sabina is asking, what are the differences between types and interfaces? I promise we will get to that. That is in this section. We will get there. So a type alias, here's one difference with interfaces. A type alias can hold any type that you are able to define in TypeScript. So we could say, something like that, might be null, string might be null. You can put whatever you want here. That's not the case for interfaces, as we'll see later, but that is one of the great powers of a type alias. If it's a type, you can give it a name and then you can import and export. So if we look at the example from last chapter where we're flipping a coin and we've got this maybe get user info thing, and I've got in all its full glory, there's your return type. It's just a lot of syntax here, right? Lots of square brackets, lots of braces. It kind of makes you cross your eyes a little bit. So there's our flip coin. It's heads or tails. And then maybe get user info. There's its return type. So if we were to model the return type, sorry, it's as a type alias, we could do it like this. Create a tuple type, right? User info outcome error. User info outcome success. And then we could union those types together. And the tooltips get much nicer. You have words that can explain what the meaning of this thing is, not just. It's a little bit like we're no longer telling someone how to build a watch. We're telling them what time it is. Like we're giving these types a semantic meaning as opposed to just spitting out the contents of the structure that we're looking for. Just like variable names, right? Like variables have a name and you can write it in such a way that it conveys like the purpose of this thing. Now you can do that for types as well. Just think of it like a variable for types. Let's create two sets here. We've got evens, like even numbers under 10. And then we've got 1 through 5, which is the numbers 1 through 5. These are two sets. And if we drew these on a Venn diagram, they would look like this, right? 2 and 4 are in both sets, but low numbers has 1, 3, and 5. They're not even. And evens has 6 and 8, which are both greater than 5. So those are not shared by the sets. Union types. This is or in TypeScript for types. TypeScript uses the pipe symbol for this, which makes it easy to remember because it's kind of conceptually related to double pipe, which we know from JavaScript as how we can express an or logical Boolean operator. In the above example, if we wanted to create the set that is represented by 1 through 5 or evens, what effectively we're saying is you're allowed in this set if you belong to either of these sets. right? If the bouncer's at the door to let each value into the set, if you're less than 5, you're good. If you're like 1 through 5, you're good. Also, if you're even, you're also good. We accept all of these values. And that's why we get this set here. This is what you would see in TypeScript as well. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8. You could think of this almost like we're taking all of the first set, and then evens, we're going to go through and anything, you know, we'll check to see if something's already in the set. And if it's already in there, we won't do anything. But it's going to find 6 and 8. And it's like, oh, I'm going to add these to the set. It's almost like some for loop like behavior is happening behind the scenes. So one thing that I want us to ask ourselves here, like there are two different modes we can think about. There's what values is a type willing to accept? And then on the other hand, what guarantees do we have? What can we depend on being true for every member of that set? So for example, here, well, what values can it accept? Anything in either set. But what can we assume? Well, if we needed to pass something that was of this type to a function that only wanted even numbers, we couldn't do that. There are odds in here. There's a possibility that it's the number 1. That's not even. So this, you can't pass for an even if you're the mix of these two sets together. And you can't pass for a number between 1 and 5 either, because you could be 6 or 8. So there's sort of two ways to think about it. What values are allowed versus what guarantees do we have? That'll be a common theme here. So let's think about intersection types. This is the opposite. Well, this is and for types. It's the opposite in some way, which I'll save that for the fancy finish here. You can think of this as and for types. TypeScript uses this ampersand or and operator. And again, like you probably use and in logical Boolean operators and conditions if you're just writing regular JavaScript. So hopefully easy to remember there. And let's look at the set 1 through 5 and evens. What we would end up with is this set. We'd end up with this set, right? It's only 2 and 4. It's only the things that are shared by the sets. When we're saying and, we're not saying all of the values in this set and all of the values in the other set. We're saying all of the values that are in this set and the other set, right? And what passes is 2 and 4. You have to be a member of both. So sometimes it's easy to get confused about like which is the and which is the or. Why do we call it an intersection type when we're using the and sign, right? It makes us think that it's like the two bubbles together. Just remember that when we describe types, we're describing a requirement, a constraint, if you will. And what we're saying here is you must pass both constraints. You must, there's like two bouncers in a row. You got to be in both or we don't let you in. Whereas up here, look, either works. Maybe there are two doors with a bouncer for each set and like you can try both and you get in one way or the other, right? So that's why this is the smaller set.